Brand new trial just came out looking at reversal of type 2 diabetes with lifestyle. They took 72 participants with type 2 diabetes and split them randomly. One group was just told to follow national dietary guidelines. Now, this trial was conducted in China, so it was Chinese dietary guidelines, but they're not too different on the fundamentals. It was basically a diet with whole grains, high in fiber, and unsaturated fats. And they were asked to eat about 50 to 65% of their calories from carbohydrate, 15 to 20% from protein, and 20 to 30% from fat, with a maximum of 7% coming from saturated fat. And they did this ad libitum, meaning you can eat as much as you want, quantity-wise, of those foods, of that diet. The other group, the intervention group, the actual experimental group, was put on the same diet, but every 10 days, they spent 5 days on a restricted diet. So 10 days ad libitum, 5 restricted, another 10 ad libitum, 5 restricted, and so on. And the restricted diet was 840 calories a day, so pretty hypocaloric, and it was 46% of calories from carb, 46% from fat, and 8% from protein. And they had 3 meals a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, at specific times that were predetermined, and those meals were delivered to them, so that all the food was provided, and they were asked not to eat anything else in between the meals. So just to recap, the control group was told to eat according to the guidelines, ad libitum, as much quantity as they wanted, and the experimental group ate the same diet, but for every 10 days ad libitum, they had 5 days of restricted calories. So the only difference between the two groups was the restriction. And they followed this protocol for 3 months. So obviously the goal with the intervention is to restrict calories, but instead of doing it daily, like in some trials, here it was intermittent. So every 10 days, there were 5 days of restriction, which might be easy for some people if you know the restriction is limited in time, it's only a few days, and then you go back to eating as much as you want, might be easier to stick with. After 3 months of this protocol, the restricted group lost about 9% of their body weight. They weighed an average of 67 kilos before the trial, and they lost about 6 kilos. The control group, on the other hand, didn't lose significant weight. They weren't very heavy to begin with. Their BMI before the trial average was 24, which in the Western Hemisphere is actually in the normal range. 25 is the cutoff for overweight. But for Asian populations, sometimes lower cutoffs are suggested. So for example, the WHO suggests the cutoff of 23 for a Chinese population. So by that measure, these guys would be in the overweight range. And their BMI fell from an average of 24 before the trial to an average of about 22 after the trial. So it fell to the normal range, even for an Asian Chinese population. In addition to the weight loss, their fasting glucose level also came down. It was about 140 milligrams per deciliter before the trial, and it dropped to 113. And 126 is the cutoff for diabetes. So their average was no longer in the diabetic range after the trial, although it was still in the pre-diabetic range. The cutoff for normal is under 100. And in the controls, there was no significant change in fasting glucose. So both the weight and the fasting glucose improved in the restriction group. There was also a reduction in the diabetes medication. 68% of participants in the restriction group reduced their diabetes meds, and 50% stopped them altogether. After the 3 months of the trial, all the participants were asked to continue eating according to those national guidelines for an additional 3 months of follow-up, but this time without restriction. So everybody was eating ad libitum. And at the end of that second 3 month period, they measured their hemoglobin A1C, their glycated hemoglobin, which is an average of the glucose levels over the prior 3 months. And the reason they did that is that these are the new criteria to say that someone is in remission from their type 2 diabetes. You want to see a hemoglobin A1C under the threshold for diabetes, under that cutoff, which is 6.5%. Above that, you're said to have type 2 diabetes. So you want to see a hemoglobin A1C under that cutoff 3 months or more after someone has stopped their diabetes meds. And if you see that, you can officially say someone is in remission from their type 2 diabetes. And I think the reason there is obvious. You want to see their glucose level naturally without being artificially pushed down by the medication. And the reason it's 3 months is because that's the time span that the hemoglobin A1C covers. So it makes sense. So their average hemoglobin A1C was 7.65% before the trial, and it dropped to 5.66 at that 6 month mark. Remember, it's 3 months of restriction protocol plus 3 months of follow-up with ad libitum guidelines diet. So they did drop below that diabetes cutoff. And actually, 5.7% is the cutoff for pre-diabetes. So under 5.7 is the normal range for hemoglobin A1C. So the average for the restriction group had just barely made it into the normal range. And in the control group, there was no significant change to hemoglobin A1C. Now, this drop is pretty respectable, but this is the average of the restriction group. So it could mean a couple things. It could mean that everybody came down from the diabetes range, or it could mean that a percentage came down a ton and some are still higher. So next, they looked at the participants one by one to determine how many were in remission. And it was 47% that were medication-free and under the diabetes range, so officially in remission. And their fasting glucose at this 6 month mark was 104 in average. So it was 140 before the trial, 113 after 3 months of restriction, and 104 after another 3 months of follow-up. Now, some variation between measurements is normal, but I was actually pretty surprised by this because usually what you see when the intervention itself is over is you tend to see a drift towards in the direction of baseline values. So kind of a rebound. But here they actually seem to improve a little bit further. They're almost in the normal range for fasting glucose, which is under 100. After that, they continued to follow them for a total of 1 year. So 3 months initially of randomized intervention and then 9 months total of follow-up. And at the 1 year mark, fasting glucose was 111. So starting to see a bit of a rebound. Similar level to the 3 month mark. And hemoglobin A1C was 6.33%. So also some rebound, but not all the way back to baseline. Whereas their body weight was still 6 kilos below baseline. So they kept it off pretty good. And it's interesting that both their fasting glucose and hemoglobin A1C rebounded a bit, but their weight stayed pretty stable. So I wonder if there's some inaccuracy in the measurements, or maybe there's some weight independent effects that raised glucose. They also looked at something called complete remission, which is where you have both a fasting glucose measurement and your hemoglobin A1C in the normal range. So not just under the diabetes threshold, but under the pre-diabetes threshold as well. So both metrics in the normal range. And about a third of the volunteers from the restriction group were in complete remission at the 1 year mark, which is pretty respectable. Another cool thing about this trial is that they're still following them. They're going to go all the way to 5 years of complete follow-up. So that'll be published. It'll be really interesting to see because normally you see a pretty significant drop-off of the gains a couple years after a dietary intervention. For example, in Roy Taylor's direct trial where they used a low-calorie diet to achieve weight loss, 46% of participants were in remission at 1 year, and by the 2 year mark, it had come down to 36%. So two major takeaways from this trial. The first one is the potential. It's possible to achieve complete remission from type 2 diabetes just with lifestyle tweaks and to get completely off medication. This is still very surprising to a lot of people, including some doctors. For a long time, there was a belief that type 2 diabetes was irreversible, that it was a lifelong condition. When I was in medical school, we didn't talk about reversing it or putting it in remission. We talked about managing and medicating. So it's really important to keep learning because the science doesn't stop. And I hear this from viewers regularly. Hey, my doctor told me there was nothing that could be done and he just put me on some meds. And then they Google it and they find this information and they get very upset. And that's understandable. So this has to become general knowledge. We have enough trials demonstrating the possibility of remission. Half the participants were no longer in the diabetic range after a few months, just with some tweaks to the diet. Nothing fancy, nothing expensive. Every doctor needs to know that this is a possibility. Now, the second takeaway is a dose of reality, that this rebound is a common observation. In this trial, we can kind of justify it because they told them to stop restricting, but we see this in all kinds of trials during the intervention, an initial period of improvement followed by a rebound. So people struggle to keep their gains in the long run, even though they've been shown how to do it, and they felt the improvement in their own skin, they still oftentimes fall off the wagon. That's how hard this can be. The other sobering realization is that these interventions never work for everyone We always see that. In this trial, half the people were still in the diabetic range. About half, 47%, were in remission. The other half were still diabetic. So the diet or the intervention didn't work for those folks. And the same is seen in direct. At 1 year, about half of the volunteers are not in remission, and at 2 years, it's two-thirds. People also often ask about Virta, which is a study using very low-carb diets. And they had about 20% of the participants in remission at the two-year mark, and about 50% that had normal glucose levels but were still on some medication like metformin. Now, there's going to be a temptation to compare these trials directly one-to-one. The number of remission is larger in this one, so this diet is better than that diet. We can't really do that. Too many methodological differences. The experimental design is completely different. So it doesn't really work out that way. But we can clearly see that all of these interventions work for some people and don't work for others. So at the end of the day, very important to remember, we're dealing with human beings living in the real world. It's not robots. So none of these diets are a magic bullet that's going to end diabetes. But having this repertoire at our disposal, all this evidence, could potentially help millions and millions of people if it's well utilized. This is why I always harp on sustainability. Finding a diet that's sustainable for you, that you feel you can stick with for the long haul, for decades, and that it's not a chore, right? That it's enjoyable for you to do it. All of this so that you don't become another case of rebound. The other question I've been getting a lot is about some medications like tirzepatide and semaglutide, some meds that have shown pretty impressive results in somewhat recent trials. And we have a whole video on that in the pipeline, so stay tuned. Here's more information on putting type 2 diabetes in remission using diet. And here's my interview with Roy Taylor, who supervised the direct trial. I guess he directed direct. There you go. See you over there.